you, good evening, and thank you particularly for staying inside on what might be the last day of summer.
Yeah.
So yes, thank you very much for joining us. I've just realised that I've left my sliding glass behind, which wouldn't help anybody. So I'm a physicist for a living. I do many other things too, as it was touched on in that lovely introduction. And I'm one of those people who's kind of into everything and has a bit of a problem deciding what to do to pay the bills. So this was me at school, playing the piano, amateur dramatics, riding horses, playing with dogs, doing music, all that kind of thing. And my art teacher was very disappointed that I decided to do science rather than art for a living, because he called me a Renaissance character, you know, someone who's kind of a bit of a polymath, can do lots and lots of different things, just has to decide on one, which was a bit of a problem. I fell in love with physics about when I was about 15, prime falling in love age, 15. And I just fell in love with the big story of it and being able to explain everything from the tiny particles to the biggest galaxies. So physics is what I do for a living, but I do lots and lots of other things in my spare time as well. Now when we hear the term Renaissance, I don't know who comes to mind. Is it maybe this guy? Leonardo da Vinci? I mean, if there's... I'm not even going to try and compete, maybe channeling the long, weary, wayward hair as I get older. Maybe not the beard. But he was responsible for a diverse mix of work. So you may be familiar with his engineering designs. We're not actually confident he actually built any of these, but they do work, quite a lot of them. So we have things moving water around, we have flying machines, we have a parachute here, just in case that didn't work out. And also very famous for his spectacular artworks, not least the Mona Lisa. But what is maybe less well known is that Leonardo da Vinci probably spent the last 15 years of his life devoting a lot of time to the study of anatomy. And it was originally thought that he did this to better inform his painting and his drawings. Obviously, if you understand the structure of people, you can depict them in a more realistic way. But when people went through his papers after his death, they found reams and reams of beautiful anatomical drawings that are really not that far off from what you find in a textbook today. So this is a heart. This is actually the lining of the gut. This is a drawing of the brain, maybe slightly less wrinkly than you'd see in most textbooks today. And this is a baby in the womb, which is actually quite an adorable little picture. And I went to see these drawings when they actually exhibited at Buckingham Palace about 2 years ago, and was staggered by the level of detail. So how did he get these lovely pictures in the days before CT scans? Well, he had a rather close working collaboration with a professor of anatomy at Padua University, and you can still go to Padua University and see the anatomy theatre that Da Vinci would have been in and would have seen dissections and quite possibly performed them in that setting. And it was actually a theatre. People would go for a night out to see a body being cut up, and they'd have music at the interval and snacks. And this was how you learnt how the body worked. You had to take one apart and look at it and do beautiful drawings like Da Vinci did if you didn't have the privilege of going to a setting like that. And thus it continued for hundreds of years, from like 1500s when Da Vinci was working, right up until this guy, Rogan, who was a mechanical engineer and physicist, and he was working on something called a Crux tube, which was a bit of a curiosity back then. It had a low density gas inside, and you switch the electricity on, and there was an anode at one end and a cathode at the other end, so you attracted the ionized gas inside it to the different ends of the tube, and it glowed this kind of funny green colour. And it was a kind of party trick that you'd have, you know, have with a brandy after dinner. It shows your Crux tube and show it off to all your friends. And he found out that actually the radiation from the Crux tube wasn't blocked by a paper, that it could get through various objects, even his wife's hand. I sincerely hope he also experimented on his own hand, and not just his wife's. And he got the Nobel Prize for Physics in 1901. But there was one slight problem with x-rays, which will hopefully be illustrated by this multimodality imaging box, which is sponsored by all major manufacturers. I'll just show you the label on the side. There we go, so it's not to discriminate against anybody. And also a very helpful app which finds me around cave systems with my two little sons and also helps with this illustration.
Somewhere and
three of them and they're all different shapes. And if you kind of work it out, if you look at even your mind will build up a picture like that. And mathematically you can do the same thing to put together a 3D image. This is Hounsfield. This is a original sketch on a notepad somewhere sunny, presumably maybe on an evening not too similar to this one. And this is an experimental system he built in the late 60s. And this is actually a slice of, I think, pig brain he was experimenting on. You know, if I radiate this from all different angles, can I put together an image that looks like that? It's what physicists call a test object. We like test objects because we know what's on the inside. And if we get an image that looks like what we know is there, then we know we're right. So quite likely it's there. And this is the first CT scan with a gap just big enough to put your head inside. The first head scan was done in 1971. And Hounsfield shared the Nobel Prize for Physics with Colmack in 1979. So it was recognised really, really quickly as being an innovative imaging technique which really can make a massive difference. So this is this may or may not work. I'll try it here, but if not, we will have to default to the internet. This is what a CT scanner actually looks like with the covers off. No, it doesn't, so we'll go down here. So this side you have the detector bank, it's this long bit, and the CT tube is directly opposite it. And this is as fast as it goes when we're scanning things that are moving quite quickly like the heart. And you go in the middle if you're having a CT scan. Anyone have a CT scan? That was what was happening inside that nice benign looking donut thing that you were lying in your scan. So as it's going round and round and round and round really, really quickly, it's taking pictures from all the different angles and you are moving through the bed so it can survey that whole length of you and can build up a 3D picture of where the structures are in your body. Now you can see why we keep covers on. It's not just to keep the dirt out. Hounsfield, not CT scans, has developed those into a commercial model. They're going into hospitals thick and fast in the 1970s. The problem with CT scans is that they're largely dominated by bones. You don't see a great deal of detail of your squishy bits. And of course, most of the bits of you that go wrong are your squishy bits, your teeth, soft tissue, and the details inside your lungs and other cavities. So there was a real need to develop something that could image soft tissues really, really well. And in the late 60s, round about the time Hounsfield was working on CT, this chap, Damadian, started doing experiments on looking at how different tissues responded to different magnetic fields, something called nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy, and it's a tool that's used in laboratories across the world for a wide variety of applications. And he was looking specifically at how tumours and normal tissues behave. And he built a sort of prototype system to say, well, in theory, you could take measurements inside a person and do these studies actually inside a person. But here it was an idea, he didn't actually action it, which was actually a bit of a mistake, because a few years later on, Lutzler, who was a chemist, Mansfield in Nottingham, he's the chap with the tie, always tell the supervisor in any group he has a tie, and the students were being experimented on, obviously, and they went ahead and he worked out how you could use magnetic fields and radio waves to locate where these signals from different tissues were in space. So he developed this technique. So Lutzler basically went, this is the idea, this is how we're going to find these signals from these different tissues in the body. We're going to track them down and place them somewhere so we know where they are. And it was Mansfield's group who actually went and built the thing in Nottingham. Mansfield sadly died earlier this year, about a month ago, and I actually met him when I was at university in Nottingham, which is one of my few claims to fame. He's a true legend of the field. It took them a bit longer to get the Nobel Prize, but they got there in the end, 2003, for their contribution to physiology and medicine. So, a brief explanation of how MRI works, because it's very different to this shiny x-rays with people making shadows, that sort of thing. The first thing you need is a big bag of hydrogen atoms, a person will do, because we're largely built up of water. So we've got an awful lot of hydrogens attached to all those oxygens. And when the hydrogen atoms have a proton in the middle that behaves in some ways like a little magnet and in some ways like a little spinning top. So you can imagine it as having a direction, a north and south pole and a spin. This is all the weird stuff that you get to do if you do physics at university. If you then put that in a magnetic field, it will not just stay there like that, like a little bar magnet pointing sort of north to south. It will actually process like this around the direction of that magnetic field. And to illustrate this, I need three volunteers. Is anyone feeling... Anyone have an interest in contemporary dance, perhaps? No? Just like going out on Saturday night? I'll just pick up people if they don't come out. I've got Brendan for a start, if you wouldn't mind coming out, sir. Round of applause. So if you could kind of take a position here, I need two more. Come on, you're standing. There's someone who doesn't get dizzy easily for the last one. Go on, excellent, go on. Round of applause, please, two guys. Experiment on it and then we can sort of transfer it down the line. Right, so what I'd like you to do, nice and tall, imagine you're drawing a circle on the ceiling with your head. I'm not going to do it because I've got heels on and that could be disastrous. So kind of keep your body straight and just draw a circle on the ceiling. Nice and slow, nice and slow, nice and slow. Okay. Feel free to change direction if you get really, 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 really dizzy. I'd like you to do the same thing, but a little bit faster. Maybe come a bit further forward so you don't bash your head on the table. Just imagine you're drawing a circle on the ceiling on top of your head. A little bit faster. So, you know, the mice go even a little bit faster than that if you don't mind. Keep going. Now, if you imagine your protons, and I have a strength of magnetic fields that varies with position. So the magnetic field is getting stronger this way. So Brendan is processing very leisurely. And there's a little bit more rapid precession over here. So I can tell from how fast my protons are doing this, exactly where they are in space. And you can vary the magnetic field that way. And also, sorry, I'm not me, guys, do it at the back, sorry, it's fine. And also, if I was intensely popular and we had rows and rows and rows of seats going upwards as well, then we'd be able to have people processing and going upwards as well. So in three dimensions, we could have a varying magnetic field, which allows us to pinpoint exactly where people are in space by how quickly the protons move around. It's stopped now before you all collapse. Thank you very much. You can say, well, actually, at each point in this grid, that magnetic field is going to affect this proton in a slightly different way. So we can tell by how quickly it basically does that, whereabouts it is in three dimensions. And if those three dimensions are occupied by a person, we can say that we can tell apart the signal from one of those little squares to the one next to it. Okay, so we've got position signals sorted out, but how do we tell what sort of tissue is in the different parts of the body? Well, that was Lauterbur's second genius idea, was that actually, if you put energy into this system using radio waves, you can tip the direction of this proton from being that way up to being that way up. And it eventually moves back to the upper position with a characteristic time that's I hope to identify that particular tissue. That actually goes back to the idea that Damadian had, that you could tell tissues apart by how they behave when you put radio waves in and magnetic fields in. There's Lauterbur that actually translated that idea into building a scanner. So he gets the Nobel Prize for something Damadian doesn't. And then you can collect signals, because you've got these spatially varying, or little charges oscillating like this, pointing in various directions, coming back to that position at different rates. If you can collect all of those signals from all those little charges in aerials positioned around the patient, then you can just pull out all of those signals from each other and build an image of what type of tissue is where. And that is how MRI scans work. Anyone had an MRI scan? You're probably too distracted by how noisy it was to know that that's what's going on. What you hear with an MRI scan is of the switching between the magnetic fields, so they switch directions to try and work out where you are in space, and also the generation of the radio waves actually creates some of the noise. You can actually go and Google noises MRI scans make. So I find it quite endearing. If you ever say it's a ringtone or something, really confuse all the radiographers. So you end up with a scan that's a bit like this. This is a very, very beautiful brain. See the difference with the CT. All the lovely folds of the brain are really, really picked out beautifully. You're not far from an anatomy textbook looking at an MRI scan. And you can also pull out several other bits of information from MRI as well. So this is what we call the BOLD scan, where you're looking at how well oxygenated the blood is. So you can get some degree of blood flow into an area and out of it by looking at this signal. This is called arterial spin labelling. This is when the behaviour of the blood is modified as it's moving into the brain, so we can watch it move through the brain. And this is something called nuclear. This is looking at that spectroscopy thing, which is what Damadian did to start with. So for a very small area of the brain, you can really hone in and see which particular chemicals are in there. There's also the option of modelling what's happening inside the brain and saying, well, we've got an increasing signal here that kind of follows what happens in there, so these two must be somehow connected. And you can build these beautiful maps, which are normally the ones that end up on the TV, by the way. If MRI scans go, this is like their party dress. They end up on the BBC looking like this. And this is actually just a colour-coded version of that, showing how those regions are linked within the brain. So you can get some degree of information about how the brain's working from this and from the blood flow scans we get from CT. But they're largely structural. They largely give us lots and lots of detail. And if you go and look up anatomy textbooks, chances are what will actually be offered is an anatomy and physiology textbook, because it's actually most useful to look at the two together. Knowing the shape of something is not particularly any use if you don't know how well it's working. We need to know how well that structure is working in order to work out what's wrong with it and be able to fix it. So we need information about what the structure is doing, as well as just what shape it is and where it is in the body. And that's where my home territory of nuclear medicine comes in. So radioactivity was discovered jointly by Henri Becquerel, again, excellent beard, and the Curies. And so yes, finally we have a woman discovering something. It took us half an hour, got there in the end. And then we have Anderson, who actually discovered the positron. Most people know about him, but we really rely on positrons in terms of imaging. In terms of the birth of nuclear medicine, I could pick out many people who contributed to its development, but the two key players are Hevesy and Anger, and here they are. Not so much a beard or moustache. And this is Hal Anger, who gets the prize for best dressed physicist for having bright red shoes and bow tie. That's quite a look. So Hevesy was actually a chemist, and he came up with the idea of being able to add a small amount of stuff to a bigger system in order to discover what that system was doing. And there is a story which may or may not be an urban myth, but I'm keeping it because it's really, really nice story. That he was staying in lodgings at the time, and he suspected that his landlady was recycling his leftovers into his next meal, because everything looked a bit the same from one day to the next. And he added a small amount of, I hope it wasn't big activity, meal, lovely, to his dinner. And then he monitored the dinner as it came out the next day and went, aha, there he'd be recycling my leftovers from the previous day. So that's an idea of the tracer principle. You can add a small amount of stuff to something to see where it goes. And that was about 1911, the first tracer experiments were done. They were tried out on plants and then animals in the 1920s. So if you're wondering what was happening in the gap between CT and between X-ray, CT and MR, well before CT and MR, these principles have been developed into medical imaging. Now, there were several sort of forerunners of scanners before I came along, but his type of imaging was developed in the late 50s, it became commercial in the 70s, and gamma cameras that we use now work on very similar principles. So in nuclear medicine, you're pleased to know we generally let our patients keep their clothes on, and we inject them with radioactive stuff, and that radioactive material tracks through a particular process in the body. It's taken up in that process and is retained by it, so we can see where that trace has gone. We can then take pictures of where that injection's gone, and